little ones.
Okay. Good morning, good morning, good morning.
Good morning.
I don't know that I can wait. I've got a funny for you, and I was going to wait to share it later in the morning, but it's the first thing that came to mind, and so I'm just going to go with it. How's that for opening a service with a joke? By the way, welcome to Palm Sunday. Oh, this is going to be a great Sunday. Yes, you have your palms, don't you? And so whenever you, that's right. Hey, those are my palms. Whenever you feel a hallelujah about whatever it is, feel free to, yeah. We're going to look at verses and about the triumphant entry, and we're going to have a good time with our banners. Are you ready for this one? A guy is driving around the backwoods of Montana, and he sees a sign in front of a broken-down, shanty-style house, Talking Dog for Sale. By the way, this joke comes to you from Bob Poet. He rings the bell, and the owner appears and tells him the dog is in the backyard. The guy goes into the backyard and sees a nice-looking Labrador Retriever sitting there. You talk? He asked. Yep, the lab replies. After the guy recovers from the shock of hearing a dog talk, he says, so what's your story? The lab looks up and says, well, I discovered that I could talk when I was pretty young. I wanted to help the government, so I told the CIA. In no time at all, they had me jetting from country to country, sitting in rooms with spies and world leaders, because no one figured a dog would be eavesdropping. I was one of their most valuable spies for 8 years running, but the jetting around really tired me out, and I knew I wasn't getting any younger, so I decided to settle down. I signed up for a job at the airport to do some undercover security, wandering near suspicious characters and listening in. I uncovered some incredible dealings and was awarded a batch of medals. I got married, had a mess of puppies, and now I'm just retired. The guy is amazed. He goes back in and asks the owner what he wants for the talking dog. $10, the guy says. $10? This dog is amazing. Why on earth are you selling him so cheap? Because he's a liar. He's never been out of the yard.
Okay, that was funny.
Yeah, it's kind of so-so, Bob, but you asked me to read it. Oh, I think that's hilarious. Okay. Let me read to you from Psalm 62. Truly my soul silently waits for God. From him comes my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. Are you finding yourself needing a defender? Someone who will do your battles for you? Let the Lord do your battles for you. How long will you attack a man? You shall be slain, all of you, like a leaning wall and a tottering fence. They only consult to cast him down from his high position. They delight in lies. They bless with their mouth, but they curse inwardly. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual powers, which is all the more reason why we need to ask the Lord to be our defender.
Yes.
Our job when it comes to flesh and blood is to love everyone, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah.
In fact, it's interesting. That's how we do battle. We do battle by asking the Lord to fight our battles, and we do battle by loving others. Nothing changes a heart like love. Amen? My soul, wait patiently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. Have you come this morning with an expectation to meet the Lord? I have. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. In God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Pour out your heart before him. David is well aware of trouble in his life. And yet he recognizes that his battle is not against flesh and blood, but he's pouring out his heart to God. Do you have things that are troubling for you this morning? Beyond that, do you have prayers that absolutely must be answered, especially when it comes to our families? This morning, as we worship, think of it as an opportunity to pour your heart out to God. Don't allow it just to be a song service, but allow it to be an opportunity to pour out your heart to God, to pour out your concerns, to pour out your prayers. Pour out your heart to God. Surely men of low degree are a vapor, men of high degree are a lie. If they are weighed in the scales, they are altogether lighter than vapor. Do not trust in opposition, nor vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. What are we setting our heart on this morning? Is it riches? Is it external things? Is it things that come and go? Or are we setting our heart on the eternal faithfulness of God? The goodness of God that knows no end. God has spoken once, twice I heard this, that power belongs to God. Also to you, O Lord, belongs mercy, for you render to each one according to his work. Shall we stand? Lord, this morning we come to you in worship, Father, and we all have cares and concerns. Lord, we all have areas in our life that we need you to be our mighty warrior. Lord, we need you to do battle. Lord, this morning as we desire to come before you and pour our hearts out to you, O God, Lord, we ask that you would do battle in regards to those thoughts that create confusion, those thoughts that can make it difficult for us to focus on your goodness, Lord. God, we ask that you do battle on thoughts that are not of you this morning. And Lord, that we would pour our hearts out, for God is our refuge, God is our defense, God is our strength. And Lord, our expectation this morning is on you. Lord, we have an expectation to meet with you and to experience your deliverance in our thoughts and in our souls. In Jesus' name, let's worship the Lord. Who's that? I took Jesus as you want the baptism? Yeah. Hallelujah. Oh my goodness. Way to go, Valika. Keep bringing them in. I took Jesus as my Savior. You take him too. I took Jesus as my Savior. You take him too. I took Jesus as my Savior. You take him too. Way beyond the blue. Do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do remember me. Way beyond the blue. Amen. And there's a lot more where that came from Tuesday night at 6 o'clock. Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for these gifts that you have given us, and it is such a pleasure to respond to you in thanksgiving by giving them back to you, Lord. Father, direct us, Lord. Direct us in all things. In Jesus' name, and the church said, amen. Amen. Oh, did our Sunday school teachers leave? God bless them. This is the last week that the current crew is going to be with the children. And so if you would like to help out with Sunday school, please let me know. I know many of you have already signed up. And so don't think that I've forgotten because you're not getting a call. I have got your name. And so we'll be letting you know about when it's your turn. And so Sarah is, no little ones today? Okay. And so Sarah, this is the last week. I think in April we're going to have the kids with us quite a bit between Easter and Membership Sunday. And then we're also going to do some fun things with the kids. But again, if God has called you to work with the children on Sunday, please let me know. And we'll get you good and trained and you'll have fun. It'll be wonderful to worship the Lord in that way. All right, Father, thank you, Lord, for this Sunday being Palm Sunday, the Sunday that is your entry into Jerusalem is celebrated, Father. For the Jews, it was a day of deliverance, Lord, and Lord, we are going to get into that this morning. Father, so speak to us, Lord. Speak to me, Lord. Help my thoughts to be clear. Lord, keep me from distraction. Father, there are things that you want to say to us this morning. Each one of us, Lord, you want to speak to us in a personal way. And so, Father, help me to be a part of what it is that you're saying this morning. Speak to us, Lord, in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. This is the word of God. It is powerful, it is alive, and it is able to change our lives. Amen? Amen. Let me ask you a question. Are we worshiping Jesus for who he is, or are we worshiping him for who he wants to be? Let me say it again. Are we worshiping Jesus for who he is, or are we worshiping Jesus for who we want him to be? My first reading comes out of Isaiah 60. Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. This is a prophetic word given to the children of Israel through the prophet Isaiah. It speaks of a reunion, a rebirth of the nation of Israel that encompasses the globe, that in fact kings will come to Israel as they witness the brightness of God's glory upon them. The goodness and glory of God. We're talking about big things. We're talking about big things, the glory of God, the power of God, the demonstration of God over the people of Israel, like a sunrise upon them, a glory seen by other nations. Isaiah 55, 5 through 9 says this, nations who do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Boy, if that's not underlined in your Bible, dear ones, underline it. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. God is speaking. God is speaking to you. He's speaking to me. Seek him while he may be found. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Scripture again and again is speaking of a time that the glory of God comes and changes everything. How many know that it's not just speaking about the nation of Israel? It's speaking about you and me. The glory of God, the power of God, the presence of God in our lives. Seek him while he may be found. Who doesn't want that? Who doesn't want the very reflection of God through us? Who doesn't want such a radical change of heart that we are completely his? And yet in Isaiah it says this, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. God is going to do what God wants to do. And what God wants to do is to be glorified through his creation. But his ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts. And so this is why it's so incredibly important that we develop a life of prayer. And not just praying for others, but that we understand that when we pray, we are literally coming before the Creator of heaven and earth on our knees and saying, oh God, if there be any wicked way in me, if there be any anxious thought in me, if there be any selfish thought in me, if there be pride in me, Lord, change my heart. As we pray, I hope, dear ones, that you're not running to the needs of others. There's time for that. But we begin with our Father, which art in heaven. Holy is your name. Why is it important to recognize the holiness of God? Because you and I, apart from the righteousness of Jesus, are not holy. Our thoughts are not in line with his thoughts. Our ways are not in line with his ways. And we absolutely must develop the habit of being with the Father and allowing him to speak to us. And I hope that while you're praying and you're on your knees before the Lord, because that is the proper position, that you're praying with the scriptures there and you're reading scripture and you're asking God, God, change me, Lord. Make me more like you, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. I don't think the way you think, says the Lord. The way you work isn't the way I work. The way I work surpasses the way you work, says the Lord. The way I think is beyond the way you think, as comparing the sky being high above the earth, so his ways are high above us. I don't think that anything shows this as much as what's called the triumphant entry of Jesus in Jerusalem. Again, the question begs to be answered. Are we worshiping Jesus for who he is, or are we worshiping Jesus for who we want him to be? Clearly, the Jews were seeing Jesus in according to how they wanted him to be. Certainly according to scripture, but they misread the scriptures. They forgot to go a little deeper and recognize that God's ways and God's thoughts are not our ways and not our thoughts. Yes, he'll bring glory. Yes, he'll come to us and he'll manifest himself to us and he'll hear our prayer and we get to enjoy him forever. But his ways are not our ways. We must seek him to know him. The triumphant entry is mentioned in all four of the Gospels. It's one of the few times that we see in all four of the Gospels this triumphant entry. It was a big day in Jerusalem. In their minds, Jesus was coming to restore Israel to its former glory according to the days of the reign of King David. See, it was happy days are here again. I almost played that song for you that I think came out of the 20s. Happy days are here again. The sky above is clear again. Let us sing a song, something of cheer again. Happy days are here again. It was a celebration. They are going to experience Jesus coming into Jerusalem. And the zenith of the power and the prosperity and the influence of Israel will be realized as it was in the reign of King David. Happy days are here again. Woo, woo. Woo. That Jesus was entering Jerusalem as a king, anointed by God, as their Messiah to free Israel from their captive Rome and give Israel back their sovereignty so that they can worship God properly, and that God would allow them to live in abundance, and Jesus as their king would bring justice. And all of the Old Testament scriptures, the very glory and presence of God would be known throughout the earth. That Jesus was now coming out of local ministry onto the national stage to be now a great political leader and a military leader who will win battles, be a great judge, and make righteous decisions. A wild celebration. This was a day unlike any other day. It was a day that for the Jews, all of their prayers, the longing of their heart, the things that they have desired and prayed for since childhood, this is the day that it's happening. Maybe it looks something like this. We have a video.
On a donkey.
Picture there if you can. Not that picture. That one's okay, but I was thinking of the other one. Okay. Maybe it's not something you could do. Okay. As Jesus enters the crowds, they lay their clothes on the ground and wave palm branches as they shout, wave these with me, would you? As they shout, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna. What they're literally saying is, he who saves us has come. He who rescues us has come. Our Savior, our Redeemer, the one who is going to answer all of our prayers, bring justice to us, meet all of our needs. He is our King, and we will once again experience the kingdom of David. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. They weren't asking that he save them. They were declaring that this is the day he saves us. They were declaring that this is the day he's rescued us. They were declaring that this is the day of days. Oh, happy days are here again. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahweh, the Lord, creator of heaven and earth. Blessed is he who comes in his name. All power, all authority. He is now our King. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Shouting, Jesus is the King of Israel. The Romans are there. They're hearing all of this. This is traitorous language. This is coming out like few times before, declaring with loud voices and great celebration, Jesus is our King. What a day. Dear ones, are we worshiping Jesus for who he is? Or are we worshiping Jesus for who we want him to be? See, his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. And you can be sure of this, that as we worship the Lord, that as we give him praise, that as we welcome his reign, and as we welcome his power and his sovereignty over our lives, that His ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts. This was an event of God's size, proportion. Luke says in 19:39 through 40, and some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." But he answered and said to them, "I tell you that if these should keep silent, the very stones would immediately cry out." Oh my goodness. This is beyond our natural order of things, that stones would actually cry out in celebration. Matthew 21, 9 through 10. All the city was moved, saying, "Who is this?" Some of the city, just a few of the folks, maybe the 12 and his disciples and a few close friends. No. This was all of the city. In fact, John 12, 12 through 15 is kind of amusing. The Pharisees are beginning to criticize themselves because they see the popularity of Jesus and they kind of turn on one another and they say this. The Pharisees therefore, John 12, 12 through 15, the Pharisees therefore said among themselves, "You see that you are accomplishing nothing." They're criticizing one another because they see the popularity of Jesus. And they say, "Look, the world has gone after him." This was a major event. Jesus was openly declaring to the people that he was the king and Messiah they had been waiting for. They wanted a savior from Rome. They wanted peace. They wanted freedom. They wanted victory over oppression. Jesus offers them far more. A savior from their sin. They wanted peace. They wanted freedom. They wanted victory. And Jesus is coming to bring salvation for their sin. How many know that you can be in a free society and still be in a cell of sin? How many know that you can be in a free society, a democratic society, a capital society, a society where there is no limits upon you and you can be all that you want to be? How many know that there can be justices and there can be police and there can be fire departments and there can be order and you can be in the bondage of sin? When he failed in their expectations, you see, they came to worship Jesus according to not who he was, but who they wanted him to be. And when he failed in their expectations, within just a few days, their hosannas would change to cries of "crucify him." Oh, dear one, there's something very powerful about that statement, that we would know ourselves. Amen? When Jesus did not fulfill their expectations, they were done with him. And they said, "Crucify him." Oh, dear ones, if our expectations of Jesus is the litmus test of whether or not he is God, you will fail. Because his ways are not our ways. And his thoughts are not our thoughts. And trust me, Jesus has called you and I to a life that is anything other than natural, comfortable, pleasant. He is not. He's called us to a life that he would be king. You see, Jesus did not come to reign in a palace. He came to reign in our hearts. And Jesus said that if you love one another, by this, all will know me. He came to reign in our hearts, not in a palace. Are we worshiping Jesus for who he is or who we want him to be? Jesus came to bring peace, freedom, and victory over oppression and sin. One of my favorite veterans is a fellow by the name of Captain Charles Plum. I came to know him because he's a speaker for one of the local RV places. And he and I are corresponding on email, and I'm hoping to get him here as a speaker. But here's his story. Captain Charlie Plum graduated from the Naval Academy at Annapolis and went on to be a fighter pilot flying the F-4 Phantom jet on 74 successful combat missions over Vietnam. On his 75th mission, with only 5 days before he was to return home, Plum was shot down, captured, tortured, and imprisoned in an 8-by-8-foot cell. He spent the next 2,103 days as a prisoner of war in communist war prisons. During his nearly 6 years of captivity, Captain Plum distinguished himself among his fellow prisoners as a professional in underground communications and served for 2 of those years as chaplain in his camp. Here's what Captain Plum says when he gives his presentation. If you go online, oh, by the way, our furnace is working. Can you tell?
Yes.
Thank you. Me too. Here, if you look up Captain Charlie Plum, you'll see his presentation. He is probably one of the most sought-after speakers in the country. He'll wear his flight suit, and on the stage, on the platform that he's standing, will be an 8-by-8 square illuminated by light so that you could get an idea of the captivity of this man, the cell in which he lived. And you know what he says? He says that of prisoners of war, there is less PTSD than any other soldier. Why? Because in their captivity, they learned how to live. And the way they learned to live was by caring for the guy in the next cell. Rather than being preoccupied with their own troubles, they were preoccupied with the troubles of the one next door, and they made it their mission to serve one another. Captain Plum says, "Don't kid yourself. Don't cry for me," he says, "for my 8-by-8 cell." Because many of us are in a cell of our own making, about 8 inches in width. The battle is here, dear ones, and Jesus came to set us free. Jesus did not come to reign in a palace. He came to reign in our hearts. Can you say amen?
Amen.
See, you and I can be free of all trouble externally and be miserable in our hearts. We all know people like this, don't we? Where they seem to have everything, but they have nothing. Where they seem to be full of external pleasures and external achievements. They have power, they have position, but they have no peace. They have no freedom. They have no victory. And they are enslaved to all kinds of addictions and all kinds of sorrow. Jesus came, not in the palace, but it's come in our hearts. Question, are we ready to accept Jesus for who he is? You see, he offers peace. Philippians 4:7, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. You see, he doesn't come to bring peace by taking care of those, excuse me, he doesn't come to bring peace by taking care of those who are troubling us, by taking care of those who are making life seemingly difficult, by taking care of those who are not treating us justly. That's not the kind of peace that he comes to bring. He comes to bring a peace that's within our hearts and minds. I love the phrase, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul.
Amen.
Sung by a man who just happened to be on the very spot that claimed the lives of his children in a cross-Atlantic passage. He had the peace that surpasses all understanding. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Only he can bring his peace into our heart. A peace that says, it is well with my bank account? No. It is well with my bills? No. It is well with my house? No. It is well with my soul. For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. I am going to glory someday. Amen. And that life has begun now. Amen. Oh, slander me. Oh, take up weapons against me. Oh, find allies against me. I belong to Jesus. He is my strength. He is my defender. He is my rock. Amen. I promise you this. If your pursuit in life is prosperity, if your pursuit in life is position, if your pursuit in life is to be well thought of by fickle people who will change one day to the next, good luck. Jesus wasn't interested in any of that. And yet, I tell you, there was never one who walked on earth that was more satisfied in who he was and his life and his purpose than Jesus Christ. And he had none of that. He saw it as dung. Peace. He offers us peace, not out of a palace, but from our hearts. He offers freedom. John 8:36, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. I love Don Francisco's song. He's alive, he's alive. He's alive and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. You know, the enemy is said to be the one who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He will lie to us about our sin. He will exaggerate our sin. He will bring guilt and shame upon us, and these things have a way of shackling us and causing us to not see who we are in Christ. You see, when you and I said yes to Jesus, the scripture says he threw our sin as far as the east is from the west, or east-west, however it goes, from all the way that way to all the way that way, never to be seen again. And if you are finding yourself harassed by the enemy concerning past sins, just give it to Jesus. Amen. He died not so that you could be kind of forgiven. He died. His righteousness was not almost there. His righteousness is complete. He fulfilled all of the law, and now he is risen, and he makes intercession for you and I. As if he's showing himself before the Father, if you will. He makes intercession. He intercedes between you and I. And the Father cannot deny the Son. He loves the Son. And he loves you and I like he does the Son. We have freedom, dear ones. Don't allow the enemy to lie to you. And if there's a sin that you fall into, you repent of it. And you go on with Jesus. There is no amount of you and I waxing over our sin and waxing over our misdeeds that will fix it. So leave it alone. Give it to Jesus. Invite his Holy Spirit and say, Lord, fill me and use me and make me your own. I give you my sin. I repent of it, Lord. Lord, teach me not to do it again, Father. Show me the triggers, oh God. Show me all the things that are connected to when I really get myself in trouble. Lord, teach me all those things. But as it relates to my sin, it is forgiven. It is thrown in the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered again. That sounds like freedom to me. What about you? We're free of it. We're free of it. Jesus came to not only reign in a palace, but within our hearts, victory over oppression and sin, to live as newly transformed people. Joshua and I are memorizing this verse together, Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. See, you and I being at church this morning, we're presenting ourselves to God, are we not? Yes. Yes, we are. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, it's only according to the mercies of God that we can do anything that's pleasing to the Father. And Paul says, I beg of you, I beg of you, I beseech you, according to the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. After all, Jesus died for you and I. He's just asking us to live for him. Pretty reasonable, isn't it? Which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know where the enemy is most active in our lives? About 8 inches, right here. He will come and he will lie to you all day long. But we are called to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. You know, that's a powerful thought, being transformed. The kids play with transformers, don't they? And at one minute, it's a robot, and the next minute, it's completely different. It's a plane. God is wanting to make you and I completely different. Oh, my goodness, you couldn't get more different between Eddie and Jesus. And how does that happen? To be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Oh, dear ones, tell me that you're reading your scripture. Tell me that you're allowing the words of God to change how you think. Your destiny in living the life of Christ is directly related to your time in scripture. You must be in scripture to be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Oh, I don't have a lot of time, Pastor. Well, give Jesus what you got, even if it's a couple of verses. But don't let it be just a reading exercise, but recognize that this is the Word of God, and it is powerful, and it is able to change our lives. And as we open the Scriptures, and as we read a verse or even two, and we say, oh, God, would you do this in me? We're called to live the life of Jesus, dear ones. And we're transformed by the renewing of our minds, that you might prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Oh, these are grandiose thoughts. That by the renewing of my mind, by the transforming of how I think, that I can actually demonstrate the will of God. I got a lot of reading to do. I've got a lot of scripture to read, but I'm committed to it, and I hope you are too. By the mercies of God, we're committed to this. It is our preoccupation to live the life of Jesus. That's what it means, dear ones, to consider ourselves as Christians. Oh, that term has been overused, I'm afraid. It's a lot like the word love. I love pizza and I love Jesus. We've overused these terms and they begin to wane in significance. How about this? Call ourselves Jesus followers. We're called to be like him in thought, word, and deed. Are we worshiping Jesus for who he is, or are we worshiping Jesus for who we want him to be? This is what Jesus says, and then I finish with a story. This is the life that he's called us to. Peace, victory, freedom. Matthew 6, 24 and 25. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. You know, it's interesting. They took up a palm branch, and it was the day of days. It was the day that all of our prayers are answered. This is the day that God comes in glory, that God deals with our enemies. Once again, the kingdom of David is here. And Jesus says, take up your cross. Remember Jesus in the garden. Father, not my will, but your will be done. Because of it, we're all here today. Because of Jesus doing the will of the Father and enduring the cross, we have all been born again. Thus began more than 3 decades of travel around the world as a tramp for the Lord, as Corrie ten Boom described herself. She told people her story of God's forgiveness of sins and of the need for people to forgive those who had harmed them. Corrie herself was put to the test in 1947 while speaking in a Munich church. If you don't know, Corrie ten Boom was in a prison of, was in a concentration camp for hiding Jews from the Germans. She saw the atrocities. She saw people marched in of all ages, from very old to very young, marched into ovens. She saw their bodies discarded like just trash. She saw her very sister die. She saw people sleeping on mats that were full of lice and rats. She saw the brutality of guards that were raping and destroying people's lives with great glee and joy. She saw all of it. In 1947, she was put to a test speaking about God's forgiveness once she was released. At the close of the service, a balding man in a gray overcoat stepped forward to greet her. Corrie froze. She knew this man well. He'd been one of the most vicious guards at Ravensbrück, one who had mocked the women prisoners as they showered. It came back with a rush, she wrote. The huge room with its harsh overhead lights, the pathetic pile of dresses and shoes in the center of the floor, the shame of walking naked past this man. And now he was pushing his hand out to shake hers and saying, a fine message, Fräulein. How good it is to know that, as you say, all of our sins are at the bottom of the sea. And I, who spoke glibly of forgiveness, fumbled in my pocketbook rather than take his hand. He would not remember me, of course. How could he remember one prisoner among those thousands of women? But I remembered him and the leather crop swinging from his belt. I was face to face with one of my captors, and my blood seemed to freeze. You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk, he was saying. I was a guard there, but since then, he went on, I have become a Christian, and I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things I did there. But I would like to hear it from your lips as well, Fräulein. Again, the hand came out. Will you forgive me? And I stood there. I, whose sins had again and again to be forgiven, could not forgive. Betsy had died in that place, her sister. Could he erase her slow, terrible death simply for the asking? Could she erase her slow, terrible death simply for the asking? The soldier stood there expectantly, waiting for Corrie to shake his hand. She wrestled with the most difficult thing I had ever had to do, for I had to do it. I knew it. I knew I had to do it. This is following Jesus, who now occupies my heart rather than a palace, for I knew freedom was there. For I had to do it. I knew I did. The message that God forgives has a prior condition that we forgive those who have injured us. This was the place of my Jesus. Standing there before the former SS man, Corrie remembered that forgiveness is an act of the will, not an emotion. I will obey you, Jesus. Help me, she prayed. I can lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling, oh God. I can lift my hand. Corrie thrust out her hand. And she says, as I did, an incredible thing took place. The current. Oh, Lord. The current in my shoulder raced down my arm, sprang into our joined hands. And then this healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing tears to my eyes. And Jesus, who comes not to occupy palaces, but the hearts of men and women, was there as she said, I forgive you, brother. And she says, I cried with all my heart. You see, that's the justice that Jesus brings. the justice of letting go, the justice of forgiving. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Do you know how God works in our life? He often does the complete opposite that you and I will do. I just had this conversation with someone just the other day, one of the elders, who advised me to do something that was the complete opposite of what I was thinking to do, and I knew that it was Jesus. Jesus is calling us to let him reign in our hearts. See, it's the kingdom of heaven that we might prove that which is good and reasonable and perfect will of God. We are citizens of a different land, dear ones. The kingdom of God is ours. Before we're American citizens, we're citizens of the kingdom of heaven, and we are to live according to that life and according to those values and according to those principles, and it looks a lot like Jesus. And that will change this world, and that will bring the glory of God, and that will turn the heads of other nations. These people do not have a kingdom, but they are all under the banner of Jesus, and look how different they are. Jesus only is the Prince of Peace. He came to set us free. Dear ones, let's not be confused. Let's worship Jesus for who he is and not who we want him to be. Amen? What did you hear? Worship team, come on up. What did you hear? What is God saying to you in all of that? Tell me. Carson. Well, I appreciate the question, because we try to quantify, don't we? But what I want you to hear is that if you are feeling strong about a certain direction but don't have peace about it, consider the idea of going in a different direction. You see, we can discern the will of God by the word of God and by peace. If we do not have peace, don't let it become a rational exercise for you. Don't try to figure it out. Go with the peace. Go with the peace of God. Even if it seems to be contrary to what you want, what you've desired, what makes sense to you, go with the peace of God, according to the word of God, of course. I think I'd rather keep it there than... What did you hear? Come on, quickly. What did you hear? Johnny.